on the phone with us one of the best trainers in boxing, Teofilo Lopez, the father of Teofilo Lopez, who won, I think your son won from everybody, gave him Fighter of the Year. Am I right? He won the award?
Yes.
Congratulations. What a tremendous year.
But, we won the best two, you know, the best two, the highest one, which is Ring Magazine and the BWAA, you know?
Yeah.
The Boxing Writer Association Award, which is the highest that you can win.
Yeah.
You know, and that's, we're marked, we're in the books, bro. It's not like something like you think we are, or maybe we are. No. We're right there, right next to Canelo, you know, because Canelo won it last year. And I'm right next to Eddie Reynoso, because he won it last year. So, you know, it's just amazing, bro. We took over 2020, like I said, the takeover was real.
Yeah, no, you called it after 14 fights. You said after 15 fights, he'll be champion. 16, he would be undisputed.
Yes.
So what's the plan now? I mean, is it Kambosos? Is it Haney?
Listen, whatever my son wants to do, it doesn't make...
Turn right.
No,
then turn right onto Greyhound Lane.
To us, it doesn't matter who it is, man, because to tell you the truth, we're not even worried. You know what I'm saying? We beat the man we had to beat to get all the titles. I mean, to get all the belts.
Turn right onto Greyhound Lane. Then
now we go on and fight whoever we have to fight, you know? We're not going to take nobody lightly, neither, you know? We're going to... Every fight that we get ready for, like we're fighting a world champion.
No, absolutely, and that's why your son is where he is, and that's why you are where you are. But, Junior, I wanted to ask you this. Ryan Garcia, it looks like he's going to fight Manny Pacquiao. It's like 90% done.
Well, that's because people don't want to respect boxing no more. You understand what I'm saying? I heard it's like an exhibition fight. Is that true?
I talked today to Justin Fortune, who's Manny Pacquiao's coach, and he wasn't sure, but he was under the impression that it's going to be a fight, and he said that Manny stops Ryan in six. But I don't know if it's an exhibition or a fight. I just don't know.
Well, if it's an exhibition, it's just disgusting. You know what I'm saying? Manny's already an old man. You know, I told my son to try to get that fight. You know, because it will be great to fight Manny. It will be, you know, we'll get a lot of recognition if we beat him. I mean, I don't think it's a fight that's going to make my son, like, it's going to make him popular because, you know, he has a lot of followers. But that would be the only reason why we would want to fight Manny Pacquiao. You know, I think he's too old already. I think he still has it, you know. He could still beat some guys out there. You know, I don't think he could beat my son, though. Not at 135.
No, but if your son fought Pacquiao at 140, what do you think would happen?
We'll beat him as well. You know what I'm saying? Because Manny Pacquiao fights it with one angle. You know what I'm saying? He does his thing. He does his same. He steps the same way, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. My son reads that real quick. You know, to beat my son, you have to have a lot of tricks up your hand, up your sleeves. You know. So for him to do that, he will have to, you know, he will, I mean, don't get me wrong, Manny Pacquiao is a great fighter. I'm not taking nothing away from him. I just think that his age, you know what I'm saying? He's already there. He's already almost in the 40s, right?
42. So,
oh, he's 42 already? Oh, definitely not, man.
Yeah, but he looked good his last fight against Thurman. He's a champion. He's a current champion of 47.
Yeah, but who's Thurman? Who's Keith Thurman? You know what I'm saying?
He never lost. That was his first loss.
I know, but Keith Thurman is not the same fighter. He was off for like 2-3 years. You know, the guy was... I just think that fight will be a good fight for my son. I think we will beat Manny Pacquiao. And I think we will beat him convincingly.
How do you think Ryan does against him?
I think Manny will stop him. You know, especially with what happened with Luke Campbell, you know, a fighter that's not known for being a devastating knockout puncher, you know, to drop Ryan like that, so, you know, so easy, you know. And I told you, Ellie, I told you before that fight that, you know, that Luke Campbell didn't have no heart.
No, you know, said he had a mentality of a loser.
He has a mentality of a loser. And I said it. I said, if he goes in there And he's that Luke Campbell from the Olympics, and it's different. But Luke Campbell lost his desire of being a great fighter. You know, every time he had a chance to be great, he will fail. So, you know, who did Ryan Garcia beat? He beat a guy that doesn't believe himself. He beat a guy that was turning around in the sixth round, bro. Like, he didn't want nothing to do in that ring. You know, a guy that had four losses or three losses. I don't know how many losses he had, but he had more than three or four. So, you know, you can't base yourself off of how great you are off beating Luke Campbell. You know what I'm saying? To me, I think that was the easiest fight that he could have gotten from a guy that's well-known, you know, in Luke Campbell, you know, to make him look good because he fought Lomachenko, you know. And you know, he did pretty good. He had some good rounds there with Loma. I don't take nothing from Luke Campbell. I just think the Luke Campbell that Ryan fought, I think, wasn't the same Luke Campbell that fought Lomachenko. Not at all. You know what I'm saying? So I really believe that for people to shut everybody up, I think these guys, like everybody in the 135 weight division, should at least fight a Nakatani, Lomachenko, a Comey, you know. Even Comey, you know, Comey already got three losses. So, you know, we beat those guys. I think that nobody in the 135 weight division as of right now could beat Lomachenko. I don't think so. I think Lomachenko is going to come back with a vengeance. I think that that he's going to be really focused on his next fight. And how come they don't mention him? Nobody's mentioning Lomachenko.
You know why? This is what gets me about boxing. I love the sport. I love everything about it. But there's one thing I don't like. In MMA, in basketball, baseball, football, in every other sport on the planet, wins and losses are part of the sport. No one's going to stop being a Laker fan because they lost a season. No one's going to stop being a McGregor fan or a Nate Diaz fan or a Masvidal fan if they didn't win a fight. But in boxing, you lose one or two fights and they erase all of your accomplishments, which is wrong because everybody wins, everybody loses. But Loma, he lost to Salido early on, we know, but then he redeemed himself, three titles in 12 fights. He fought your son. Your son's a phenomenal fighter. Your son's legend, Hall of Fame. Lost that fight. Doesn't mean that he's not good. It just means that boxing culture, all of a sudden, oh, he lost, and we think he's nothing, which is wrong because he's a great fighter.
Exactly. Okay, you want to limpiar bien. Okay, no, I was just talking to my wife. Sorry.
No worries. Yeah, no, but I would like to just...
Listen, let me explain to you something, okay? Listen, and you know all this shit about we're scared of Devin Haney, we're scared of Tank, we're scared of... we took a risk, a big risk in fighting Loma, somebody that nobody wanted to fight him, somebody that Loma was chasing, you know, Loma was chasing Tank. What happened? You know, Floyd thought that he wasn't ready. And he never, that fight never happened. So, hello, these people, man, they don't leave me alone. But anyway.
Hey, it's hard being popular.
What I'm saying is, we took that risk, okay? We took the risk with Comey. We took the risk with Loma. Then everybody was bashing us because they didn't know this guy named Nakatani from Japan. And I told everybody, that guy will give the 135 weight division problems. Look what he did to Verdejo. These are predictions I made before the fights even happened. You understand?
Yep.
And that's why I'm the best coach in the world right now. You know, because I predict things, I see things that other people can't see. Everybody, bro, the odds were like 4-1 in Vegas when my son fought Loma. You know, the odds were against my son even with Comey.
I know. You know, I know a lot of people that made money off your son with Loma.
Yeah, because of the Nakatani situation.
But here's the thing. Let me tell you something about the Nakatani fight, Junior. Your son won 11 of the 12 rounds. And everybody, because he didn't get the knockout or whatever the case may be, people in boxing, you don't even have to lose. They just was looking for a reason to hate. That's all it was. And they wrote him off after that fight. Oh, he got exposed. He got this. And he won clearly.
Exactly. You know, all that shit he had in his face were headbutts. And I told everybody, to me, he won every round. There was not one round that Nakatani dominated. You know what I'm saying? Where you could say, okay, he took the fight. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
I know what I got, bro. And that was my son with fucking family problems.
Yep.
He wasn't even in that fight. You know, he was looking around the crowd, and I'm like hitting him in the chest. And I'm like, what the hell are you doing, bro? This is a title eliminator fight. You can't be worried about just your family out there or what could happen. You got to focus on this fight. And that was like in the third, fourth round, I told him this. And he was never there. He just wanted to be over with, you know? And you know what happened after that? You know, everything is beautiful now. He's living with me now. He's going to move here. He already moved to Vegas, you know, as we speak. And we're going to start getting ready to train. We're going to start getting ready for the next fight. My son ain't scared of nobody, bro. No, I know who I, you know, you see, this is one thing that's weird about my son. He's not even scared before the fight. He's not even scared of going into the ring. You know what I'm saying? Because he just wants to entertain the public. You understand? That's his job. I mean, since he was a little kid, since he was 8 years old, his first fight, I told him, listen, this is not about winning. This is about entertaining. You got to entertain the public. And this is just the beginning, Ali. If we did it in 2020, what do you think we're going to do in 2021? We're going to fight the tough competition. I mean, we're already talking about fighting Jose Ramirez, fighting Josh Taylor. You know, these guys can't even knock out dudes in 135. What do you think is going to happen when they move up to 140, 147? If they can't bring that, power into those weight divisions, they're going to have a lot of problems. You know, the only thing that I'm concerned about, I want to get them before anybody else does. You understand? Because I want my son to fight all of them and beat them all. But I want him to be the first.
No, of course. Now, the other day I interviewed Jose Benavidez Sr. And he has a fighter, Ryu, Jose. And they were telling me that they sparred your son. What do you remember from that day, from the sparring?
This is what happened. We went there. We sparred them. They were getting all a little bit excited because the kid was doing a little bit good. I don't take nothing away from the kid. The kid is okay. You know, he's not in our level. And, you know, I remember that he busted up David Benavidez's nose, and he busted up the other kid's nose. He made both of them bleed because he sparred both of them.
No, Jose, David's the 68.
Oh, no, Jose Benavidez, the one that fought Krause.
Yeah, 47.
So,
Jose.
Yo, he made him bleed, and he made this other kid bleed. So, he made both of them bleed that day. My son didn't feel good, right? So, my son said, listen, man, we did like five rounds with them or six or whatever it was. My son wasn't feeling good that day. So, my son said, Papi, I don't want to continue. That's it. But it's not like he stopped them. You know what I'm saying? When a fighter doesn't feel good, he doesn't feel good. So I told myself, don't worry, we get him another day. Then when we came back the other day, the next day, or whatever it was, a couple of days later, you know, my son blew him away. You know, they're lying because they want to give this guy clout. You there?
Yeah, no, I'm listening. But listen,
wasn't
there.
Wait, the car turned off. Hold on a second. Hello, you still there?
Yeah. No, we're here.
You went to the phone anyway. You went to my phone because I had you on my speaker. But okay, so listen, if they stopped my son the first time, how come they don't got video of it? And if they knew they stopped the first time, how come they didn't have video of him the second time? Every time I spar with my son, they ask me if they want video. I say, yeah, go ahead. I don't give a damn. You know, so you know. Let them do what they got to do, you know, and I understand what they're trying to do. They're trying to build this kid up. You know, how a kid that's 6-0 with only 3 knockouts is going to freaking stop my son in sparring? It's ridiculous. You know? You see that?
Yeah, no, of course. I wanted to ask you this, Junior. So right now we are in almost February. Your son, when I talked to you guys at the Mike Tyson podcast, you guys thought you're going to fight in April. Do you think April is still realistic? That's 2 months away.
Of course. We started to train. we started to get ready because there's a lot of offers out there, and we're definitely going to fight in April or May. You know, I want him to stay busy. I want him to fight at least three times this year. Hopefully that happens. Hopefully, you know, they vaccinate everybody and this COVID thing goes away.
You can have a gate.
Exactly. And it's going to be huge. You know what I'm saying? Because right now, by him beating Loma, you know, the true fans, not the casuals, but the true fans are going to watch it. But there's millions of them.
No, of course. Listen, your son's popularity, his Instagram is like almost 500,000 followers. He's growing. Being on the Mike Tyson podcast, I don't know why they took 2 weeks to release the footage, but I'm glad they finally released it. They should have released it the same day. But I was going to tell you this. I talked to Justin Fortune today, who's from Australia. And I said, what do you think? He's one of Manny Pacquiao's coaches. He's the strength and conditioning coach for Manny. What do you think about Teofimo Lopez and Kambosos? And do you know what he told me?
Yeah.
What do you think he said?
He says he's probably very optimistic about the fight happening.
No, yes, but he also said that your son destroys Kambosos. And I said, Justin, you're from Australia. He goes, yes, but I'm also a realist.
Oh, of course. You know, I mean, I don't think there's anybody alive right now that could beat my son, you know? You know, at that weight division, you know, at 135.
Kambosos is tall. He has speed.
I mean, no, the guy's a good, you know, you know what he reminds me of? He reminds me a little bit of Diego Magdaleno, you know, the way he fights, a little bit like him, you know, and, you know, his style, you know, he's just an inside-outside type of fighter, you know, and those type of fighters are the fighters that are going to get knocked out by my son. Because we don't have to go chasing them like we did Loma, you know what I'm saying? But things could change too, you know. Once you feel my son's power, you know, it's not the same saying something. Once you're in there with him in the ring, it's a different story, you know. He turns into this animal. And Loma, listen, we're talking about a guy that had one loss in the amateurs.
Yeah.
He had one loss in the amateurs. And he avenged that loss. So, you know, and he had like maybe 397 fights out of that. He beat everybody. He had different styles that he beat, you know. And he just can't beat my son. You know, I never said that Loma was you know, that Loma didn't know how to fight. I just said he couldn't beat my son. And look what happened. You know, and I predicted that my son was going to knock him out in six rounds. You know, but what happened? He ran. You know, so it's hard to knock somebody out when, you know, when they're not there, you know, to fight. So that's the only reason why we didn't knock them out. We got close to it in the last round, you know, but you saw the referee stopping the fight 10 seconds into the last round because my son got cut. You don't do that.
Yeah.
You know, you don't do that. And if that would have happened, my son would have stopped him.
And your son had a fracture in his foot. A lot of people don't know
he
that.
He had a broken toe. He fought with a broken toe, and he fought with a messed up shoulder. You know, but we didn't say nothing about it. You know, a fight is a fight.
Junior, every fighter, from what I know, always goes in with something. Nobody's ever perfect. There's always some issue with something, you know?
Yes.
But here's the thing.
Yeah.
Loma, if he comes back, who do you want to see Loma fight?
Any one of these guys that are bragging, any one of these guys that are bragging that they have done something in the 135 weight division, and name me one guy that has done something in the 135 division. Nobody. Nobody. The only one is my son. You know, none of them has fought a champion. You understand? Every time they fight, they were never the underdogs. You understand? So who the hell has they fought?
So
want to come and just step up to the front plate and fight my son.
Who would give Loma the best fight between Tank, Ryan, and Teofimo?
Between who?
Between
not my son, right?
No. Between, Gervonta Davis.
Devin and Ryan.
Correct. Sorry.
I think maybe Tank. You know, because of his power, he still got that one punch, you know, denominator that he could use. You know, it depends. If he could catch him, I don't think that Loma is going to stay in the ropes like Leo Santa Cruz did. You know, right before the fight, you know, Leo Santa Cruz people came up to me and asked me, you know, could you give us some pointers? I said, you know, just fight him tall, you know, don't let him get in and stay away from the ropes. And they didn't listen, bro, you know, because Leo Santa Cruz was on the ropes almost, you know, in the sixth round. He stood there. He wasn't moving. You know, Tank was throwing that punch all night, and he couldn't catch him. You know, as soon as he went on the ropes, that's when he caught him. You know, but the thing is, that guy wasn't even a 135-pounder.
No, they fought at 130. They were both at 130 for that fight.
Yeah, they fought at 130, but he's not even a 130-pounder. I mean, I believe Leo Santa Cruz only fought. That was his first time fighting at 130.
Second. He won the title. Second. He won the title. He beat this kid from Texas to win the title. He was ranked 8. But look, Leo has 39 fights, and the difference of 26 and 30 is 4 pounds. It's not like he jumped up, you know, 6 weight classes. And Leo's a tall kid, and, like, making the weight, he looked better big. And you have to give Tank credit because that was a beautiful ending. Like, he finished it in a nice way.
Yes. But what was happening before the fight, before that knockout? He was already what you call it, winning every round. To me, Leo was winning every round until that last punch. So, you know, that shows you that a fighter like my son would destroy Tank. You know what I'm saying? Because we would never let him come in. You know, and we got that punching power that's going to keep him away. Leo is not known for knocking guys out with one punch. Leo is known for stopping guys with a whole bunch of punches, you know. But, I mean, that was a great fight for Tank. We're willing to fight him. But Floyd is over here saying that he needs a tuna fight, you know. So right there, you're telling me you don't want to fight us, you know. My son has been at 135 for 7-8 years.
So wait,
you know, it's time to move.
If they call you tomorrow and they say, are you guys willing to fight Tank in May? And Tank's available and your son's available, that fight could happen?
In a heartbeat. I will take that shit in a heartbeat.
That would be a mega fight. That would be a major pay-per-view fight. Major pay-per-view.
It's not going to happen, though, Elie, because they don't want it. They know we're going to destroy him, bro. You know, and that's the only fighter that Floyd has right now. He's not going to lose his best fighter. And man, I'm telling you, man, whoever fights my son's next is in for a big beating because my son already said it. He talked to me. He says, Dad, don't trust me, man. I ain't going to do this shit no more. I'm just going to go for it. You know what I'm saying? Because you look what we did to Loma. We showed that we could box. You know, that's the only reason why he boxed the way he boxed, because he wanted to show the people that he's not only a puncher. What would have happened if we would have knocked out Loma in 2-3 rounds? You know, people would have been still talking shit.
Yeah, no, they wouldn't give you shit. They wouldn't give you any credit. They would say, oh, you caught him cold. He was this too small. I know what they would say. But let me tell you this much from knowing Tank and knowing fighters in general. I don't think there's any fighter that's scared to fight anyone. People want to fight the best. And if you ask Tank if he wants to fight your son, I'm sure he would say yes. And I just don't... It's the same thing with Loma. If you ask him...
But it doesn't matter. Elie, it doesn't matter because their promoters and their managers are not going to let them. You understand?
It's just like when Ryan wanted to fight Tank. He wants the fight. He would have gotten it. If the Pacquiao fight didn't come, I believe Ryan would have fought Tank next.
I believe that too, but they're not going to let him. They don't think that he's ready. You understand? The only reason why Top Rank let us is because, you know, we proved with Kobe. We proved with Kobe we could fight the pound for pound king, and we beat him. You know, they didn't think we was going to win. Top Rank never thought we was going to win that fight.
By the way, speaking of Top Rank, well, you guys did win and you won convincingly. Today, Bob Arum met with Oscar. And maybe they talked about TV dates, but maybe they talked about doing a fight with your son and Ryan. What do you think about that?
Bob wants that fight. Bob wants that fight badly, you know. And when we're interested in the fight as well, as soon as he dropped Campbell, you know, as soon as he stopped Campbell, I told my son, I called David. I called David McWhorter from Split Management. I called him. I called my manager. I called my son. I said, yo, make the fucking fight. Make the fucking fight happen.
And what did he say?
You know, but then... they're not going to do it, bro. I don't know. You said they just talked today. So, you know, I'm not into the negotiations. When I see the negotiations are going to fall for something that I want, then I talk. You know, and then I give my son my you know, what I believe. And that's why that fight was made. Remember, my son wanted more money. He didn't want to fight Loma. Everybody, you know, started saying that my son, you know, was scared, you know. And I told my son, listen, man, we get those belts, bro, that's worth more than anything in the planet right now. Let's get those belts. If we let this guy go right now, bro, we're never going to get this opportunity again.
That's true.
And it's going to make your career even harder.
High risk, high reward. You got to take sometimes the fights where people don't believe in you, but if you believe in yourself and you know what you have, you got to do it.
We're the only ones doing what the greats has done in boxing. You know, this social media shit is just killing the sport. You know, there's fights where my son, you know, wants to fight, but then he doesn't want to fight him because, you know, he doesn't want to be involved in that world of social media. You know what I'm saying? We want to fight real fights.
Okay,
we don't
so let's say
the public fighting ridiculous, stupid fights.
Ryan Garcia, Teofimo Lopez. How do you see the fight unfolding?
Well, my son will kill him. He would destroy him. It wouldn't even be a contest.
Why do you say that? Ryan 21-0, 18 knockouts.
Because I know my son and I know who we could beat. I know my son like the palm of my hand. There's nobody out there that could beat him right now. Nobody. I mean, and my son, listen, my son hasn't won by split decision. All his four fights that he hasn't knocked out a guy has been by unanimous decision. So as of right now, we're like 100. You know, you got other cats that I want to name, you know, Hall of Famers that they don't have a record like we have right now. I mean, the record that we have right now is never going to be broken ever in boxing history. I mean, they had never, the lightweight division had never been undisputed. And when we took all the belts, that had never happened. And we did it. My son did it at 23. He could have probably done it at 22 because they stopped the fight on May 30th. We lost $2 million because of the COVID. We lost him being 22 instead of being 23. You know, a lot of things happened. We made this happen during, you know, impossible times. You know what I'm saying? And we still made it happen. You know, for something like this to happen again, I don't see it. I don't see it happening.
I agree with you. At 16 fights, at age 23, never. It just can't happen because you're something special. Because most fighters at 21, 20 barely turn pro, number one. Number two, to get a chance to fight for all the belts, you have to fight so many people and no hiccups. It's almost impossible. And if your son moves up to 140 and fights the winner of Jose Ramirez, Josh Taylor, he has opportunity to do something special too.
And that fight's going to happen because the whole world's going to want to see it. And we want it. And they want it too. You know, because my son is a bigger name than those guys. You know, he's way bigger name right now than those guys put together. You know, because we have accomplished things that nobody has ever done in the sport of boxing. So I don't see no reason why Josh Taylor wouldn't want to fight my son. I don't see no reason why Jose Ramirez wouldn't want to fight my son, even though he's saying that he has to move up to 147. So I don't know what's going to happen. You know, I just want to make sure that we undispute the 140 weight division. And that's what I look for. I look for moments like that, you know, and the way that God is putting it to us is like it's ridiculous. It's crazy. You know, like I said before, the only thing that could stop us right now is health. You know, and my son is in the best health of his life. You know, I'm doing good as well. You know, I feel young. I feel like 20 years old, you know, and it's just amazing to know that we still got big, you know, other challenges that we could, you know, make us even better than what we are already. You know, so I'm looking forward for that fight. You know, we definitely going to fight one more time at 135. I don't know if we could do it twice. But, you know, it was almost impossible to think like 2 years ago or a year and a half ago that my son was able to keep that weight this long, you know. So for us to still be fighting at 135 is just remarkable.
It is. So let me ask you this. We're almost done here. We're talking to Junior Teofimo Lopez's dad. What's the biggest weight you see your son fighting down the line, like in 3 years, 4 years, 5 years?
Listen, he carries his punching power very well. I mean, I don't think that he has gotten to his peak. I think that he still needs a lot to learn, and especially in boxing, because, you know, the way I train, you never stop learning. So I think that he's going to get better. Every fight, he does get better, you know, and I believe that fight with Loma made him a way better fighter and a way better boxer, you know, and we carry that punching power. I mean, my son spars with big dudes, you know, Sean Porter, you know, we spar with a lot of big dudes in the past, you know, and I see him going all the way, maybe up to 160. You know, you never know how much he's going to grow. He's still got like 3-4 more years to go before he stops his growth. So, you know, he just turned 23. It's not like he's going to go to 24. You know, he turns 24 in at the end of July, July 30th. So we still got a couple more months left. You know, I think he's going to beat a good name before he hits 24 years old. You know, 25, 26, 27. Then we start moving up to the weights. I think that even if he does 147, and maybe I think that he could even jump to fight somebody just like Canelo is doing right now. So I think because of his boxing IQ and because of the way he could carry that punching power, you know, to a higher level, I think that that's going to make him very dangerous in those weight divisions. I feel bad for the other guys, though, because if they're not killing people right now at 135 and dropping them dead, you know, I think they're going to have a lot of problems moving up in weight.
And Junior, to end this interview, how does all your son's success and your success, because you won Trainer of the Year, how has your life changed? Do you get recognized more? The lot of people, a lot of selfies?
Yeah, man. Yeah, we was in Miami, man. We had a good time, man. We was hanging out with Lil Wayne, you know.
How was that? What did Lil Wayne tell you? Is he going to do a song about you?
Yeah, let's see what happens, bro. But let me tell you something. You know, we're not the Ryan Garcias. We're not the Devin Haneys. We're not the Tanks. All those guys grew up with all these, you know, Hall of Famers. They grew up with all these giants in boxing. So they were already known before they even came into the pros. My son was never known. He just came out of nowhere. Why? Because that's the game that they play in the amateurs. It's who you know. You know, it's a corrupt sport. So that's why my son doesn't have all these followings, you know. But I don't care about that because that's going to come.
Yeah, and you were hanging out with Edgar Belanga. He's going to be a superstar.
Yeah, Eric Abelang is another guy. You know,
he loves you, by the way. He gave you a lot of love on the videos.
Oh, of course, you know, because they know, man. You know, the Latinos are coming, bro, and we're coming strong. And right now, as you know, we're doing it in music and we're doing it in boxing. We're doing it in a lot of sports. So, you know, it's just great to have that feeling that we're going to have a great, you know, some great Latino champions, you know, like Hector Camacho, you know, like all these great, great Latinos from the past, you know, and it's just the beginning, Elie. I mean, this is just going to blow up even bigger than it's already big right now. So, you know, all we need to do is entertain. My son cannot wait to get back into that ring. But we want a crowd, Elie. We want a crowd. That's what we're looking for. You know what I'm saying? Because that excites my son. My son even told me, Papi, look what I did. And I did it without a crowd.
That's true. You know
how hard that is to do?
You're right.
You know, and he was focusing there like an eagle. Like, you know, listen, ain't nobody in boxing right now with my son's boxing IQ. He figures you out, and that's very dangerous in boxing. Even Floyd Mayweather says it. All you have to do in boxing is adapt to your fighter. Once you adapt, you're going to be reigning for a long time. And my son adapts easy. Yeah. You know?
And it's
that's
not,
what makes him great.
Not
you know?
Easy to
Everybody
do.
Everybody stays at the same level. We already have surpassed these guys. And you know what makes you better? When you fight the real competition. You understand? Because that gets you sharper. You know? And I can't wait. This 2021, we're going to do the same thing. You're going to see the same awards given to us. You know, for me to go to an event in October that I'm going to be invited to and to speak to all these greats, it's just like a dream come true, man. You know what I'm saying? And I just can't wait for that moment. And I mean, I really didn't think about myself because I'm always thinking about my son, you know, but I take the awards just the same way my son is taking them. You know, I've seen a lot of change in my son. He respects me even more now that he knows that I'm the best trainer in the world. You know, and it's just like a dream come true, man. I had a whole week with him. I just came back from Florida. He put me in a jet, in a private jet. You know, we're living the dream, Elie. You know, and you know, these things that are happening right now is that blessing from God. I told everybody that, you know, and those are my words. I told everybody, you know, even before they announced the winner of the Lomachenko fight, I screamed at everybody. You know, that I didn't want to hear no more, nothing about Lomachenko, Papachenko, because they were glorifying these guys, you know, and I don't take nothing from them. They deserved the wins that they had. You know, this guy was no pushover. You know, Lomachenko could beat anybody right now at 135 and 130. You know, I really do believe that. And people are going to see that, you know. People think that it's easy. It's not easy, man. You know, the way we took out Colmey was just unbelievable. You know, that's when I knew my son was ready. But I've been knowing that my son's been ready since 2 years ago. And I predicted that he was going to win a world title in 15 fights. And in 60 fights, he was going to take all the belts when we beat Lomachenko. Well, I mean, who the hell predicts things like that?
Well, I'm going to tell people, they may not know this. But the first time I met you and your son, it was before the Olympics. You were sparring at Mayweather's gym. And you told me back then, Elie, you're watching the next biggest star in boxing. And your son didn't even go to the Olympics. He was still an amateur. He wasn't as famous as he is today. He didn't beat Lomachenko. And you already knew then that he would be an all-time great.
Man, I've been knowing him since he was like 8, 9, 10, 11. You know, but especially when it really hit me was when he started beating up world champions at, you know, in sparring at the age of 12, 13, 14. That's when I really knew. You know, and not even close, you know, and listen, no matter what I say, no matter what we do, they're always going to talk bad about us, Elie. I mean, you got a lot of haters too, Elie, and you, because you're doing your job.
Yeah, but
you know,
I love it.
You're the only one there. Every time I turn my head around, you're there.
Hey, who was it? The Mike Tyson podcast?
Exactly. So, you know, you're doing your work. You know, nobody's doing what you're doing. You know, so you have your haters.
Yeah,
you know,
but
people talk bad about you.
But Junior, you know what my philosophy is, and I've said this for many years. If I was a fighter, I'd want to be a champion. I want to be the best, right? So if I'm going to do what I do, I have to outwork everybody. They're not going to work as hard. They could be better, more connections. The promoters could love them. I don't have the connections. I do my own. It's not like anybody says, oh, I'm so-and-so promoter. Come right now. We'll hook you up with interviews with our superstars. I do the own. So I got to outwork him, and it's working. If you work hard in life, you get results, right? Whatever you do.
Yes, so. Exactly. You know what I'm saying? And that's what we do. When we get ready to fight, we get ready to fight. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but your son's always in shape. He doesn't need like time to get in shape. You know, he's always doing push-ups. He's always jumping rope. He's always doing dips. His shoulders got huge right now.
Bro, who have you seen jumping rope the way my son does?
Duran.
Nobody, man. Robert Duran was a monster too. You know, so you compare them to those greats, you know. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, he's very dedicated to his sport, and he's even more dedicated now after he beat Loma. You know, he's nobody has seen nothing what this kid is gonna be able to do in the sport yet.
No,
you know, even though we have done a lot, you know.
So, Junior, what's your message to your fans, to your son fans, if they're tuning in right now?
A message to the people?
Yep.
Stay tuned, because there's big things coming, and we're going to be announcing something big real soon, you know. But we're working on the next fight, and everybody's going to find out real soon.
All right, there you have it. Stay tuned, Junior. FiercelyReporting.com, Elie Seckbach reporting. So, there you have it. Another great video for ES News. FiercelyReporting.com, I'm Elie Seckbach reporting. And you can follow me on Twitter, at Seckbach. And you can follow me on Instagram, at Elie Seckbach.